Hey crew, I've got the key to this 22 Audi S3. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check it out what looks on the inside and outside. All new generation A3 S3 422, with a sharper look on the outside and the S3 adding some muscularity to that. It's a large honeycomb grille, and with the black optic package, it's got a black gloss border and some black exterior details on the car. Larger corner vents on the S3 versus the A3. The right side is functional, the left side is not. Full LED headlights is standard on the S3, LED matrix headlights with the Prestige package, and they do some cool animations when you lock and unlock the car. S3 badge here, fake vent between the hood and grille on the S3. This one's painted in Navara Blue Metallic. It's a beautiful color, kind of hard to see on a cloudy day like today, but in the sun, it super duper pops. Standard 18-inch wheels on the S3, upgraded to 19s with the black optic package. It's got a machine finish on the outside and gloss black on the inside. Those are wrapped in Bridgestone Potenzas, 235 section front and rear. And when you see the red brake calipers, it means you're looking at the S Sport package. That means you get adaptive dampers. Gloss black for the side sill, mirror caps, window trim, and roof. Looking at the profile, a lot of muscularity going on here with the flared wheel arches front and rear. Looks really good. Of course, I wish I was looking at a Sportback model, the hatchback, but we're not getting it here in the US. Womp womp. At the rear, you get full LED taillights, a subtle lip spoiler on the S3. With the black optic package, the quad exhaust ports are blacked out, and they are four real exhaust ports, by the way. Mild diffuser in between those. Some more fake vents. It's a really sharp looking subcompact sedan. My favorite looking one in the segment. And this spec is really good. Let's check out that interior. Opening up and looking inside at this steel gray colored leather. With the Prestige pack, you get this diamond stitch pattern front and rear. And with the fine Napa leather package, you get a supremely good feeling leather. That doesn't feel good though. That is hard plastic on the upper door panel. I like the brushed metal finish below that going into the door pull and all the angularity here, that's cool. Bang & Olufsen sound system with the Prestige package. Stepping in. This is me at 6 feet tall behind my own driving position, and I've got some knee room, not a ton, but that's okay for this segment. Foot pockets are a good size to slide my feet under. I have thigh support. I just don't have headroom. Yeah, head is on the roof. That's not great. You do have air vents and some climate control, just not digitally selectable. Two USB-C ports down there. Center armrest comes down with cup holders. That's a pretty good size one. You get LED lighting, grab handles. The drive shaft hump is not small. See if I can fit in the middle. Yeah, headroom's a real issue here. So yeah, the back seats work for smaller individuals, not tall ones. Good solid funk to that door close. Up front is a set of handsome, well-bolstered sports seats. They are heated. You get S badges embossed into the backs. They're multi-way power adjustable with four-way lumbar. Illuminated S tread plates are part of Prestige. Aluminum pedals are on all S3s. There's adjustable ambient lighting here in the doors, front and rear. The steering wheel is just the right thickness. Nice cutouts and perforations at 9 and 3. S badge on the bottom. It's not a flat bottom wheel, and it's kind of a huge diameter for the size of the car. Reconfigurable digital gauge cluster, ultra sharp graphics, head-up display on Prestige, and just look at this dashboard. It is so much cleaner than the previous generation with that tacked-on infotainment. Now it's well integrated, it's super responsive, wireless Apple CarPlay, physical buttons for your climate control settings, thank you Audi. Drive selection and traction control are there, two USB-C ports, wireless smartphone charging, tons of gloss black here. I don't love that. You touch this all the time, it's gonna show fingerprints, collect dust, it's gonna scratch. There's a tiny little drive selection here, a little nugget. Two cup holders, small center storage, with adjustable armrest. With the Nappa leather pack, you get this woven carbon fiber inlay around quattro. I like that. There's a sunroof with Prestige. Yeah, this is a fully loaded model, but it's very nice. How does it drive though? All right, let's fire it up. Some good vibrations from that turbo four banger. Already got my seatbelts on here. And we're gonna start out in auto drive mode. Sort of catch all that responds to your driving behavior. And considering the fact that the rain has been temperamental and we have a slick surface that comes and goes, it's probably a good place to start. To move it into reverse, we delicately move the drive selector forward. I don't think I'll ever get used to that. I want to chunk it into reverse, but maybe it fits the size and nature of the car. That brings up a wide angle backup camera of reasonably good resolution. It's not ultra sharp, and no bird's eye view, even though this is the range stopping trim. We do have parking sensors and a parking assist feature, which I won't be demonstrating today. If you need parking assistance for parallel or perpendicular parking in a vehicle of this size, well, I think you may need a few more lessons. Starting with a discussion of the powertrain. 2-liter turbocharged 4-cylinder. It makes 306 horsepower and 295 pound-feet of torque. Those are increases of 15 horsepower and 18 pound-feet of torque over the previous generation, and yet still not as much power and torque as the stablemate to the S3, the Volkswagen Golf R. Arr! That's what you might say if you realize that. And the Golf R also has the HGX front limited slip differential, which the S3 doesn't have. We've got a center limited slip differential, but without the vectoring between the wheels, we'll see how that plays into the driving experience. And so now at modest speeds, if you're not really digging into the throttle, you don't notice much in the way of turbocharger lag. You just smoothly get up to speed. But I want to see if we drop it down below 2000 RPM and I just pin it. Yeah, okay. So there was some defined lag there. That's in auto drive mode. We'll have to see what happens when we move into the dynamic setting, or at least put it in the sport powertrain setting. I'll say, you know, even going over lane markings like that, notice immediately that though we have the adaptive dampers with this S Sport package, the ride is on the firmer side. Audi doesn't let you forget that you chose the sporting version of its A3. Not rough, but firm. Sounds like a good leader, right? And now with as much authority as I can muster, I'm going to move the selector into sport. Yeah. We mean it. We're serious. Get some speed. You can definitely get some speed. There is that defined delay still. When you're in the lower part of the rev range as it builds up to boost. But you know it can keep you in the right part of the rev range if you use manual mode. So we're going to play with this 7-speed dual clutch automatic gearbox. Keep it in the right part of the power band. The downshifts are quick. It's a little burble even when you downshift. And, oh yeah. Oh yes, yes, yes. Feisty little car this. Those are quick downshifts. And I like the snarl that you get from that 4-cylinder when you do so. Vroom, boom. Satisfying thump when you upshift as well. Little rocket. Yeah, 5,000 to 6,000 RPM, the sweet spot of this car. Super quick car. And I'm very pleased with this 7-speed. Of course, we still have, this cracks me up. So I had a 2007 GTI. The same paddles for that DSG on that car are still found in a 2022 model year. Okay, I'm gonna take it out of manual mode. Back to sport. Are still found in a 2022 Audi product. They're the tiniest little things. I just want something better because this is such a good transmission. Give me a little more engagement vis-a-vis the paddles, Audi, please. How are the brakes though? From 67. Oh, we made the stop and I liked it. Okay, right up front, there was good bite. The pedals stayed firm throughout, giving me some confidence that I was going to stop. Of course, we have slick surface here and we have Bridgestone Potenza Performance summer tires. And yet we made a good stop there. I was pleased with that performance. How is the turning radius? Well, we're gonna find out in just a moment here. There we go. Yeah, it's a subcompact car. That turning radius is going to be great. And now we'll move out of the sport setting. I didn't even go into dynamic there. We'll do it up here. And we're going to coast for a moment and just reflect on the luxury side of the S3. I mentioned that the suspension is a little firm. It's taut, so as you go over bumps, you kind of feel it in your buttocks. And undulations like that, yeah. And the seats are on the firmer side as well, and that's not helping. They are ergonomically designed. I'm very comfortable from a driver's seating position standpoint, and the bolsters are not overly aggressive, but they are on the firmer side. I wonder how they'd hold up on a longer trip. Day-to-day use, they're gonna be just fine. Otherwise, this is a remarkably well-insulated cabin for the price point of the S3. Yeah, we got some wind noise. There's a light hum from the tires. I don't know how much of that is the road surface tampered by water. But it's pretty darn good for entry-level luxury. This is way better than even the premium end of mainstream. You hear the dollars spent in insulation. We also, as an option, I think it's part of the prestige package, question mark, we have the driver assistance features available to us. So we have adaptive cruise control and a lane keep assist feature that I've just engaged here. We'll see how it does. And it is an active lane keep assist feature, so it's, without calling it, it is steering assistance to keep you in the center of the lane. And as we catch up to this i3, it's gonna slow down without me having to hit the brake to keep that following distance. I'm pleased with this lane keep assist feature. It's way better than, I don't know how, but it's way better than the Audi e-tron GT that I had a couple weeks ago. And it doesn't make you tap into the steering right away. It doesn't make you check back in. And now, assuming this i3 isn't gonna go right, he's not, so we're gonna go into dynamic mode and hit this corner post-haste. Ah, man, red light. Okay, hard on the brakes. I could have made that. And now power through the corner. All right, so steering feel. Not a ton of it. The sensitivity to what is going on with the tires is very light, contrasted and perhaps amplified by the fact that they Audi really adds weight to the rack in dynamic mode. And so that kind of drowns out my sense of what's happening with the tires. And I will have an opportunity here to do a launch. So to prime that up, I'm already in dynamic mode. I'm just gonna hit the stability control button once. Now I hold my foot hard on the brake, builds up to 4,000. Ooh. Oh, that got out of a hole. Wow. That was a rip on summer tires on a slick surface. Wow. That is tenacious. Okay. So Audi says the new S3 will get to 60 in 4.5 seconds. No, I fully believe it after that. I kind of do it again, one more time. Foot hard on the brake, build up, 4,000, launch control activated, whoop. That was a slight uphill that time. Ooh, I like the launch control system. We'll do one more corner in the S3. Hard on those brakes, dive in, power through. You can feel the power that time going to the rear wheels, and I think sport traction is definitely the right setting to have there. Little bit of plow, not awful. It did start to rotate a little bit. I can't help but feel like a reverse staggered stance, like the last RS3 I drove, had wider front tire wears, narrow rear ones. Wider front tires, narrower rear tires, allowed the rear end to rotate by that grip on the nose. That would super duper help this S3 pivot more than it already does, but you could feel distinctly the power going to the rear wheels, and that helped the dynamics of the car. Still want more out of the steering, but you can definitely have fun in a corner. And that, I think, is the S3 to me. It is a good time, while never forgetting that it has a luxury proposition to make. Okay, there, traction control definitely stopped us from doing a nice sled. This has to stay a luxury vehicle. And what I mean by that is that this is not gonna be the outright hoonery of the Golf R that this vehicle shares its engine with. The Golf R, with the 6-speed manual option, with that limited slip differential in the front, with a hot hatch look, is just the driver's choice. This is, I suppose, the mature driver's choice. It's still fun, but you look classier, I guess. I don't know. For me, I'm always going to gravitate to something like the Golf R because I'm a child. I'm going to stop being a child for just a sec because I'm going to take it out of sport mode, out of dynamic mode, and we'll talk about the comfort. Adults like comfort, right? We're going to talk about the competition. Because if you do want to shop the luxury subcompact performance segment for under $50,000 to start, you've got three options. You've got the S3, starting at just under 46 grand. You have, and I didn't mention the fuel economy for this car. Should it matter to you, it's 23 city, 32 highway, and 27 combined. I've been seeing, let's see here, for the long-term memory, about 20 in my mostly enthusiastic driving in the car. Another option for you. Actually, it shouldn't be an option, but it is on paper. The BMW M235i xDrive Grand Coupe. It starts just a little over $46,000 and is a train wreck. As a BMW enthusiast, a previous owner, a lover, that car insults me. One, it looks hideous outside and in. Two, it doesn't drive anything like a BMW should. It drives like a front drive car that's in no way entertaining and should not exist. Okay, don't buy it. Makes 301 horsepower, gets to 60 in, or maybe it's 302, 301 or 302, gets to 60 in 5.1 seconds, so it's slower, makes less power than this. Fuel economy is the same at 27 combined MPG. Don't buy it. Mercedes-AMG CLA 35 should be one you can consider. The new generation CLA looks really good. It starts at just under $50,000, so more expensive than this. It makes 301 horsepower or 302. I can't remember between the M235i and the CLA. It gets to 60 in about the same 4.4 seconds as the Audi S3. and the fuel economy is worse at 25 combined MPG. Consider it because the interior is very nice for this new generation. The MBUX system is great. It looks good on the outside. It's fun to drive. I think the S3, though, rises above the herd with the exterior design, with this interior, the better integrated infotainment, the tech that's sharp and works well, and the driving experience that's entertaining. I like this car. I like it a lot. It's my pick of the segment. And guys, I hope you enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. And I will see you again next time.